Well, thank you all. Thank you so much. I'm actually very excited to be here and to be speaking out in Pakistan too, I guess. Mm-hmm. Is that right?
Yeah.
So this is going to be, I think, a slightly different discussion, and I hope it's one where we're able to have a lot of give and take, because although I run the Immigration Policy Center, I am trained as an attorney. I'm not a social scientist, and in fact, my academic background is in rhetoric. And one of the many things we do at the American Immigration Council, of which the IPC is a part, is spend a lot of our time crafting arguments that are used to sort of help put the immigration debate into context. And it's almost impossible to do that without spending an awful lot of your time pushing back on anti-immigrant arguments, pushing back on sort of restrictionist and nativist arguments. And I thought that what would be kind of fun to do today would be to go into a little bit more detail about some of the trends and threads of those arguments that we see. I think it very much plays into, it's the counter narrative of the work that a lot of you are doing in terms of trying to promote and understand the positive contributions that immigrants make. I mean, I think the bottom line is as a rule, immigration is a net gain for the country, and yet the predominant myths that still circulate are all about all the terrible, bad, awful things that immigrants bring to this country. And so trying to explore that and explain that a little bit, I thought would just be a good kind of counterpuntal approach to a lot of what you do here. And I thought that maybe we could think about it in terms of epic rap battles of history. If you've ever seen that on the internet, you know, Mozart versus Snoop Dogg and Darth Vader versus some evil dictator, you know, they're just very silly. But the idea is always sort of juxtaposing different folks. And it really got me to thinking that in this case, if you're talking about immigrants and the economy, you can sort of distill this down to Senator Jeff Sessions versus, well, kind of sort of everybody else. Now, I know that your center, just like mine, strives to be nonpartisan and bipartisan, and so I'm not really picking on Senator Sessions. It's more that in a lot of ways he is kind of an iconic figure in terms of advancing a lot of economic arguments that simply don't have a lot of basis in fact. One of the things I want to talk about a little bit is just sort of the enduring status sort of those arguments that are made over and over and over again. And in a way, because he's been engaged in this debate for so long, he sort of represents some of that back and forth. But, you know, so in contrast to some of the positions that we'll talk about that he lays out, an incredibly wide range of economists and other social scientists and conservative, liberal, progressive, across the board, really, you know, have made the case extremely well for the idea that when you're looking at the economic and other contributions of immigrants, you're going to find that it's really extremely positive. Nonetheless, it has always, always, always been the case that, American history is sort of filled with a love-hate relationship with immigration, and that the arguments that we hear today about immigrants and the myths are really repeated in every century, in every generation. I think everybody here, even from some of the conversations we had at lunchtime, you know, is fully aware of that. But you can go back to 1751, when Benjamin Franklin was concerned about the rush of German immigrants that were coming into the country, and how that was going to somehow or other change the essential character of our Anglophile nation. Fast forward 100 years later, and the Italians and the Chinese and any other number of other people who were coming to the country for any number of legitimate reasons, both because there were incredible work opportunities, because they were, you know, fleeing persecution, because there were family and other opportunities here. Nonetheless, despite the need and the desire and the want to have the immigrants, there was also this incredible backlash against them. And that, of course, continues to today. And I have to say, I really felt pretty gross when I was going and trying to find all the photographs to illustrate some of this, because you have to start going into these, you know, massive banks of anti-immigrant, you know, photographs and images, and there are just so many. And it's profoundly disturbing. And the one sort of positive thing that I found in all of that is that even in the ones where if you type in something like immigrants steal jobs or something, you still come across in those image banks a lot of really positive images too. So even in the, I guess, the democracy of the web, those images are at play with each other and are not consistently just one-sided. But there are some horrific, really ugly and quite frankly racist sites out there that promote images. But you can see in this last one, which is from 2010, do not hire illegals, 5% of workers illegal, 102% unemployment, deportation priceless, you know, like the visa ad. So they couldn't even get it right. But the point was, and then it says something down here about work Americans won't do, 0%. So there are so many myths sort of layered right into that that sign, but they all kind of boil down to this idea that there is a value and an essential quality to work and participating in the economy that somehow or other, by allowing immigration to occur or by you know, fostering illegal immigration, you are denying a right to native-born workers, and there are any number of sort of value-laden issues that are sort of tied up in that, and I want to spend just a little bit of time on that. But that's just to sort of give you the flavor that these are I mean, these arguments have been around for as long as the country's been around, and much, much predate our country as well, but certainly are part and parcel of you know, American culture. The funny thing, though, is that no matter how you talk about immigration, and there are many legitimate, truly legitimate disputes about what the appropriate amount of immigrants should be in the country, what type of work distribution we need, should people be legalized, should there be a path to citizenship, should there, you know, we were talking about STEM workers earlier, you know, are there too many, are there too few, are we not doing enough to encourage the education of native-born workers? Those are all real legitimate questions. But again, across the board, when it comes to the question about economic contributions and benefits, this was from a New York Times article a while back. When it comes to economics, there really isn't much of a debate at all. And from this same article, it was sort of a summary of different economic points of view and everything. So Heidi Scherholz, who's an economist at the Immigration or at the Economic Policy Institute, which is a more liberal think tank. Actually, it's important, not just a liberal think tank, but the AFL is affiliated with this think tank. And there was a point in time when the AFL was considered to be much more anti-immigrant than it certainly is today. The AFL is a huge supporter of immigration reform and immigration issues, and the debate for many of the union folks is whether you have temporary workers or permanent workers as part of that workforce that you bring in. But they're very much on the side of legalization and things like that. So an entity where there had been some real animosity towards the idea of labor competition and all of that is not only supporting this idea that we need immigrants and we need immigration, but you know, the economists that are working there, their studies, as well as everybody else's, are basically finding that there's generally net gains in wages, there's generally net gains in overall economic opportunity, and that where you find the gaps or the disadvantages, it tends to be for the folks who are at the very lowest levels of skill sets and society as a whole. So as more and more people graduate from high school, go on to college, all of that, there is a group of people who get left behind and who do potentially have more competition with other immigrants coming in and things like that. But it becomes, it's a really very tiny fraction overall of the country. And yet, it's that distinction that you have numbers that say one thing, but feelings and, in some cases, individual you know, perspectives or circumstances that tell a different story, that start to create this mechanism where we can have all the numbers in the world and still have a really, really endemic problem when it comes to pushing back on a lot of myths that deal with immigrants. Anyway, so that just sort of gives you that sense. But so what I find really fascinating, and I'm not the world's best PowerPoint person. I really wasn't trying to like force you to read every single word here or everything. But what I wanted to do was give you a sense of just how strong some of these arguments are. So for instance, as I said earlier, Senator Sessions has been, you know, a champion for a long, long time of reduced immigration. He's a smart man. I'm not belittling him in any way. He's a very smart man. He's a very crafty and persuasive arguer, and he will get up and speak on the Senate floor for hours and hours about the problems with America's immigration system and whatever the solutions are that were proposed at the time. So back in 2007, and I picked this sort of arbitrarily because that was the year that I worked for Senator Kennedy, and so I was working on the immigration reform bills. Senator Sessions was not part of the bipartisan group of Republicans and Democrats who crafted an immigration reform bill. And in fact, he was so angry about it that he referred to the eight who crafted it as the masters of the universe. And he would talk at length about the masters of the universe and how they had all these grand plans and all of these things that were a problem. But one of the things that he always came back to was the fact that there was a study by an economist named George Borjas, who's at Harvard, who had concluded back in 2006, looking at a data set from mid-90s to 2000 or so, that Americans have received an 8% reduction in their wages as a result of a large amount of immigration. And the interesting thing about this study is that it's been, if not discredited, discounted by many, 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 many other economists. But it has remained a key talking point for every person who is sort of the opinion that immigrants harm the economy, immigrants steal jobs. They always, always, always come back to this study. So that's 2007. The bill itself lost. It lost in part because of anti-immigrant sentiment and fear and concern. We were actually at that point still at a good place in the economy. So many of the primary arguments that were being pushed out about immigrants had a lot more to do with security and, you know, terrorist threats and criminal threats and things like that and overwhelming the country than they did with the economy, although the economy was a significant part. But, you know, Senator Sessions had put down his marker of this Borjas study. Go forward to 2011. Now, this isn't Senator Sessions. This is Congressman Gallagher, who at the time was on the immigration subcommittee in the House. And in 2011, the House had reverted to the Republicans. And there was a great deal of concern that since President Obama had not yet gotten immigration reform through, 2011, 2012 were going to be the years where it happened. And so almost immediately, Congressman Lamar Smith, who was the head of the immigration subcommittee, had a whole host of hearings on immigrants and work. And this particular one that I pulled up, you know, Congressman Gallagher says, look, when we hire foreign workers, when we bring in foreign workers, Americans lose jobs. This is the third in a series of various hearings that we're holding that basically show that low-skilled immigrants, you know, have a negative impact, and this particular hearing was on American minorities. And I think that I might have actually screwed up because what I had wanted to do was add one more little piece to this, which was Congressman Gallagher went on, he actually cited that Borjas piece, the same study, the exact same study. How many years later? So 4 years later, multiple studies taking place between that time, but you know, he cited the same study. And the really frustrating thing was that particularly with respect to the impact on immigrant workers versus low income African Americans in particular. There have been some really terrific studies, one by Gerald Janes, who's a Yale University economist, who actually started out in the camp thinking that there were real disparities and real discrimination, who, based on the data that he found, discovered that there are some real problems, clearly, but those problems are not really based on sort of the economic relationship between many minority or particularly African American in his study, workers and Latino workers. And there are a lot of other studies that kind of go to that idea too. That what we started seeing back in 2011 was that there was this effort to really pit different constituencies against each other. So one of the ones that was really happening, I mean, we're in a bad economic place right now. So this whole mantra that Americans are losing jobs because of immigration was, in a guttural way, I guess, much more popular. And particular attempts to divide African Americans from immigrants, to divide deeply religious people from immigrants, were going on at this time to make arguments basically that you are being harmed by immigrants and your elite, your leadership, and this would be the language that a number of the organizations that sort of promote this sort of approach to talking about immigration, they would talk about that. African American pastors support immigration, but that's because they don't care about their congregations. I kid you not. There were those kinds of things that were repeatedly said. The irony that many people point out is that an awful lot of the people who were promoting American jobs and talking about being the protectors of the American worker were also people who never voted for, increasing the minimum wage, who didn't vote for things like, better worker safety standards, things like that. That there was this dichotomy where you kind of had to ask yourself, why is the argument being used? And it had more to do with the fact that it did appeal to a certain anger and fear and concern that is generated when you have a bad economy. So, go forward to 2014. Here we have, by now, a Senate bill that had passed with, again, Republican and Democratic support, that had been scored by the Congressional Budget Office to be a huge gain over two decades for the economy. A similar bill in the House. Beginning of 2014, still some fears that the House would take that bill up. So yet again, there's a whole series in January as the new Congress is starting of Senator Sessions and other people writing about the fact that you are going to take jobs away from American workers if you pass any kind of immigration reform. And as the year has progressed, these sorts of arguments are every bit as much about the impending executive action as they are about legislative reform. And again, like I said, I didn't quite do this the way I wanted to, but in this USA Today editorial, which was published on my birthday of all things, but Senator Sessions again cites as his one piece of evidence as to why Americans are harmed whenever there's an increase in immigration, the Borjas study. Now here's the funny thing. Well, let me flip forward one. Here's the funny thing. Borjas hasn't really said that. I mean, he had the one study. But in subsequent studies, he's acknowledged that there are a whole range of things that have an impact on wages and productivity and all of that, and that really there's either a small plus or not much impact at all that can be measured. And so despite the fact that in a subsequent study, the Professor Borjas said, well, it varies a little bit, that's never acknowledged. And what I think is really interesting, this is a later part of the speech that Sessions gave in 2007. When you start breaking it down, you realize that although there's a veneer of an economic argument, there really isn't much of an economic argument at all. So, Senator Sessions, Now, Professor Borjas, who's part of the Kennedy School at Harvard, so maybe Senator Kennedy needs to meet him sometime. So right away, we see that Professor Borjas is, you know, he's part of the elite, okay? He's, you know, he's gotten here, he's succeeded, he's an expert, you know, based on that association. Anyway, Professor Borjas, in his opinion, says 500,000 immigrants a year is the right number. You know, so there's an expert. I've already told you this great study that he's shown you about why we need, you know, very few immigrants because they compete with American workers. But now, you know, he's got an actual number. This is what we should be shooting for. And then he says, now I don't know what the right number is. So, you know, this isn't me, you know, telling you this. I'm not standing here as Jeff Sessions. I'm just telling you that this smart guy, he said this. And by the way, he's a Cuban immigrant. He came here as a young man fleeing the oppression of Castro. And that's what he says. Okay? So there's very little about the economics and everything about the fact that, you know, he's an expert, he's got a solid opinion of what we need, and he's an immigrant, and he's not just an immigrant, he's an immigrant who fled communism. So this is not only a guy that we should be believing, but he's a guy that sort of trumps everything else. I don't need anything else if I've got him. And it's fascinating when you go through any of the arguments that many of the restrictionist groups make, they are laden with this kind of stuff. There will be a gloss, there will be a study, there maybe will even be a piece of information that's accurate. But there's so much more of this sort of other story that's being told that it becomes extraordinarily difficult sometimes to refute the arguments, because you can refute the numbers. You can say, well, there's 15 studies that say something differently. But how do you refute? Well, he's a Cuban immigrant who fled communism and he knows what he's talking about, you know? And so the more I thought about this, the more I thought that, well, there are a couple of ways maybe to talk about these issues in ways that at least sort of give you a little bit of an insight into what we do. And then I'll, when we finish this part up, I'll talk just a little bit about what we expect to happen in the next few weeks with executive action and such. You know, we talked about the fact that these myths are old myths. Immigrants steal jobs, immigrants are bad for the economy. And I apologize, I know a lot of you are immigrants. I'm not trying to offend you. I'm just sort of saying, you know, these are the kinds of things that get out there, you know. And there are old myths, but they are often frequently recast in new ways. So the old myth about job theft is that, you know, that immigrants will come in, they'll take a job, that they'll do the jobs that nobody else will do, and then you see like the other sign that says, well, Americans will do everything. And Giovanni Perry, who is a really great guy, see, I can say that too. He has been studying these issues about productivity and all that kind of stuff and really trying to debunk both the Borjas studies and everything. And he says, look, you can't do snapshots. You cannot do snapshots. You have to talk about what immigrants contribute, the jobs, where they are, where they go. You have to look at it in a very dynamic way. And whenever we do more than just take a tiny little slice, we see that the contribution of immigrants is enormous in a wide variety of ways. One of my colleagues often says, you know, a lot of the arguments that you see that are sort of anti-immigrant myths and things are pretty static, and they sort of assume that immigrants are like jobs are like batteries. You can just, you know, shift one person for another without taking into account anything that has to do with location, with skill level, with mobility, any number of things that are part and parcel of a dynamic economy, most of which are not easy sound bites, unfortunately. But the old myth of job theft resonates in large part because they will often sort of just take a slice of the pie and say, you know, and this is very common, there's 12 million undocumented immigrants and there's, I don't know, what is it right now, 8 million unemployed Americans. You do the math. People say things like that. That's their argument, you know. But there are new versions of this myth, and this is one of my favorites, really. Not just stealing jobs, immigrants are actually destroying our environment. So there's an organization called the Center for Immigration Studies, and David North is one of their authors, and he's written off and on about the impact of the Deepwater Horizon British Petroleum oil spill. And the argument goes more or less like this: if immigrants, especially illegal immigrants, would stay put and not come to the United States, the United States wouldn't need as much oil. Therefore, we wouldn't need to be drilling offshore. Therefore, we wouldn't need to have circumstances that would lead to the mistakes that led to, you know, the British Petroleum oil rig explosion. Had they stayed in the developing world, they would have had a much, much less impact on the globe. So again, this sort of notion that you can freeze people in time, that you can somehow or other control your own destiny by how you block other people out, is very frequently one of the themes that you see. And we have seen more and more that this sort of destroying the environment, expanding their carbon footprint, you know, all the kinds of things that in some ways you sort of see as a good. You're consuming more, you're buying more, you're moving up, is turned into a negative in that you are, by trying to improve your standing in any way, you are actually degrading the earth. Shame on you. Anyway, similarly, there's a very old myth about gaming the system, all right? And gaming the system can show up in any number of ways, but it's basically that immigrants come to the United States to take advantages of benefits, to take advantages of goods and services. They, you know, take in more than they ever put into the system. Well, again, the numerical sort of factual information is it's simply not true. By a combination of extremely restrictive laws that we have in the United States about what benefits immigrants are actually able to access, including, you know, legal permanent residence, as well as the sort of twists of fate that lead many undocumented immigrants to pay taxes and pay Social Security and pay into many systems that they are afraid to ever pull any money out of. You get this sort of factual argument that generally immigrants put more into the system than they take out. But you get the viral arguments that were very popular around 1996 and for, I'd say, about 10 years that would go around the, I don't think this happens nearly as much now. I guess people put this stuff up on Facebook rather than send you an email. But it used to be you would get these crazy emails. They started out sounding sort of normal, and then the more you read it, you realized that, you know, your friend had picked up some weird thing from somewhere, either that there were syringes in the play ball pits at McDonald's, or other crazy things like that. And one of the immigration versions of this was a story that the Dallas Morning News published in around 2006 about a Parkland Hospital. Now, Parkland Hospital was famous in American lore because it was where President Kennedy was brought after he was shot. But the story talked about, at length, the access that undocumented immigrants had to the Texas hospital systems. And what people picked up on was that there was a study that said, oh, I think I have it here. I think it was like 71% maybe of the undocumented immigrants that were served at the Texas hospitals were pregnant women. And so it immediately started being this story that pregnant women were coming over the border from Mexico to have their babies, to have anchor babies, as it unfortunately called, and you know, not having to pay a dime for anything that they were getting. Now, the way it was characterized, it wasn't really true. But what was amazing was, so 70%, so this is from the email that was going around. 70% of the women who gave birth at Parkland Hospital in the first 3 months of 2006 were illegal immigrants. Crikey! Crikey, that's 11,200 anchor babies born each year just here in Dallas, you know? So I don't even know where that number comes from, but it's just sort of there, right? Because these women are illegal immigrants, they don't have to provide any sort of legitimate identification. An American citizen would have to provide their Social Security number, which would inevitably reveal their annual income, which is just not true. I mean, but the thing about it is, it's this sort of building of an argument that really doesn't quite make sense, but there's just, you know, if you're already sort of feeling like, man, you've got it hard, and you get a story and all this sort of stuff, it's gonna start to resonate with some people. Well, then it gets even better. The person who's allegedly sent this the first time, my husband is a Navy pilot. Yep, he fought in Iraq. And while our healthcare is good, so see, I'm not complaining. I recognize it. We Navy wives don't get any of these perks, because there was another paragraph that talked about how people got free car seats and they got free baby formula and all this kind of stuff. And the thing about it is that went around and it just was driving me nuts. Well, there's a site, that an urban legend site, it's called Snopes. And they go and they kind of try to find out the origin of these kinds of things as they move around. And what they found was that when you go to the actual article, there is some of this information here. But one of the things that they found was that most undocumented immigrants who gave birth at Parkland Hospital and elsewhere had lived in the country for years. Most of them were members of mixed status families, meaning that at least one person was probably a US citizen. They, no Texas taxpayer money went to the birth of those children, because since they were US citizens, it was a federal expense. And this was the one that always got me the most, that as a whole, according to the records of all the hospitals, these undocumented immigrants had a better record of paying their bills than most of the native-born Americans that also came to the country, or came to the hospital in need. And so it's a completely, totally different story than what circulates. But it's, again, it's that same sort of thing, that there's just sort of a basic unfairness. And when you can capitalize on that unfairness in any way, it just becomes a popular myth that is really difficult to defeat, even when you do a little more digging and you find that the story is a lot more complicated. And that's the other thing, too, that is so critical, I think, about in your research, many of the things that you're looking at, you know, people can manipulate in different ways. And as you write and as you publish, it's important to think about, we were talking about this earlier, it is important to think about how could my information be misused? And it's not that you shouldn't publish. You know, you've got to put out what your research shows. But it is really important to think about framing, so that the first time information comes out, it doesn't just come out. There is an organization, I will not name names, but a very highly respected organization that has a terrible time with the media. They always, always, always lead with like the worst part of their data, always, because it's the thing that's going to get the headline. Now, 3/4 of what they found could show really positive impacts of immigrant contribution on something, but there'll be one thing that's bad, and I swear, that is always the thing that they lead with. And you spend an awful lot of your time then, if you're in an organization like mine, having to explain to people why, okay, wait, you've got to go back and you've got to read the whole study, and you've got to understand it, and you've got to put it in context. So context, context, context is everything when people are using data. Okay. Again, don't even try to read all this stuff, but the idea is, the old myth is, immigrants are always to blame. One of my colleagues says that a recent series of Center for Immigration Studies backgrounders that are designed to try to explain the cost of immigration from various states, I think he puts it very well. The portrait of state economies that emerges from these studies is one in which every misfortune since 2000 is somehow or other tied to immigration. And so some of these reports that have come out recently have been, you know, headline grabbers. All of Tennessee's employment growth since 2000 has gone to immigrants, yet natives accounted for 2/3 of the population growth. Or unauthorized immigrants cost Texas $12.1 billion a year. I mean, that's sort of like the headline that comes out. On that second one, which is from an organization called FAIR, they neglected to mention in their study that of that $12.1 billion, $7.4 billion of the cost of undocumented immigrants to Texas, or 61%, actually was K-12 education. And of that, 71% of the kids that were being educated were US citizens. And the problem is that very often in these kinds of like fiscal analyses, the groups that do them will, they'll never sort of look at the investment that education is. They'll never look at the fact that, you know, a return on education is something that, that takes years. And basically, once these kids grow up, turn 18 or paying taxes, whatever, they are never, ever, ever factored into these kinds of studies in terms of the contributions they make. So again, we spend a lot of our time just sort of taking apart studies like this to sort of say, okay, look, you got to understand it's pretty complicated. But remember we said that whole thing about they're to blame and they're kind of gaming the system and the environment issue. So this is from FAIR. Now how come we chose to include the expenditures on the US-born children? Well, because they wouldn't have been here if they hadn't come to Texas, you know? And so we assume that if the parent left, they would take their kids with them, and therefore the cost wouldn't be there, you know? So they build everything, I know it's just kind of weird, they build everything into this idea that if you weren't here, we wouldn't be experiencing these costs. Always ignoring that that also means that we might not be experiencing the goods, whatever they are. You know, immigrants are always takers, they're not givers, they're not consumers, they're not small business people, they're not investing in their education or in homes. That stuff is, I'm not saying that, that's what these guys say. That sort of stuff is never ever taken into account in most of the fiscal studies that are out there that continue to perpetuate this notion of the immigrant as taker. But this is probably my most favorite of all the myths that are out there right now. It's a new myth. It's not them, it's us. It's not them. The immigrants, they're fine. They're still, you know, coming for the same reasons. But we, America, we've changed, you know? We just can't sustain newcomers anymore. We don't need them in the same way. They can't compete with us. I mean, Mark Krikorian, who's the head of the Center for Immigration Studies, wrote a whole book about this, you know? And what I love about it is that most of the time, once you get past sort of these quasi-fact-based arguments, you very quickly get into arguments about how, you know, those immigrants, they're just not like us, you know? They're not like us. They're not as good as us. They're not as well-educated as us. It's them, it's them, it's them. And so Krikorian, this book was written in 2008, I think, you know, very craftily decided to turn that argument on its head so that he wouldn't be accused of you know, some of the nastiness that this organization, frankly, is known for, but instead he would be able to point out that we are coming to a very different kind of America, and let's see if I did this right. Modern America has simply outgrown immigration, and we must end it before it cripples us. Yeah. So let me go back to epic rap battles. Epic rap battles is good. We'll stay on that as a nice picture for this last part. But the reason I wanted to give you the sense of that is that we are moving into what I think will be a really exciting and challenging time. The immigration should be a bipartisan issue. I think eventually it will be. Right now it's not. Actually, that's a sort of a misstatement. It is a bipartisan issue. There are many, many Republicans who I think at a local level in particular are very committed to trying to change the system. Unfortunately, there is still a huge trend in Congress, particularly in the House, of people who have sort of made it their bread and butter to oppose immigration as a policy issue in order to, you know, sort of maintain their electability. We think that the demographics will change a lot in the next few years. It will make it more and more difficult to do that. There's an awful lot of evidence that the presidential race can't be won if you aren't at least trying to lay out some kind of decent policies on immigration, because immigration has become so heated and polarized that it's almost impossible for people to talk about the issue now without it sort of immediately spilling over into questions of race and class and identity and discrimination and things like that. So it is, you know, sort of very hard to tease it out as just, you know, a pure economic or a pure policy or pure anything issue, because it's so interconnected now. But what that means, I think, is that, you know, we're hearing through the news and it's very much expected that President Obama will announce some kind of temporary reform that will allow at least some portion of the undocumented population to stay in the country, at least for the next couple of years, without fear of deportation. This is huge. It's really sad, but it's huge. This will be the biggest sort of protection for an immigrant group that we've had in this country in decades. Well, I mean, DACA was the biggest one, the one for students who'd come here as children. But that still only affected a little over 1 million people. This could potentially affect 5 million more people. And every argument that I just laid out for you that is part of the sort of ongoing legislative debate will come back up in full force in the next few months as we play through whatever executive action looks like. In addition to that, there are opportunities because we pretty firmly believe, and there is some evidence already even emerging from research that's being done on the deferred action students, that the transition from an undocumented status to a legal status can have, you know, remarkable consequences, not only for the individual, but for the family and for the community. And so, you know, especially those of you who may be casting around for things to study next, tracking a group of people who get whatever this executive action status is, and hopefully find then some way to transition into a more legal status or are able to take advantage of a legal provision in some comprehensive immigration reform bill, I think has an enormous possibility both to be a great contribution, to the field, but also one that can really help us dispel these myths even more, because we can tell the story not only on the grand scheme of things, but in very individual ways about what happens when we have an immigration system that works, or at least, if not an immigration system that works, at least one that works for certain people some of the time. There's a lot of potential here, and there's a lot of potential to push back on the myths that exist with the kind of research and analysis that I think a lot of you are engaged in. And I'm just really grateful that you gave me a chance to be able to share some of this with you, and I'm happy to take the rest of the time to answer any questions you may have or let you bat it down or whatever you'd like to do.